our Coffee and Conversation series. Of course, you are here to see not me, but Martha Mitchell, a fantastic artist. You've already seen a couple of examples of his work, just in terms of style, color, imagery, and the creativity, the kind of sense of the word that I wanted to come up with was whimsy, but it's not whimsy, it's irony. I said a lot of irony because there's a lot of humor, but it's very poignant. And so I will let Mark tell you about his process, his art, and kind of walk you through his journey. So Mark, I'll turn it over to you. And you know, you can say a little bit about your background too, but international acclaim. You can read the bio on the website that exhibits in many, many wonderful esteemed institutions, and just all around good contributor to the community. So Mark, I'll turn it over to you.
Really eager to continue to hone my illustration drawing painting, explore new media in that area as well. So I was able to kind of do both. Actually painted in oil for the first time when I got to art school, not before. Prior to that, my art education was pretty lacking, so I was doing a lot of catching, but I was also amping up for a career that I knew where I could support myself, and for me that wound up being in the advertising field. And so here I am, probably scolding an account executive and telling them to tell the client, no, we can't make the logo bigger. but yeah, I was through the ranks and, you know, worked on print ads and TV commercials and packaging and you name it, billboards and all that good stuff. But learned a lot in the process. Learned to sort of, you know, supervise film crews and work with professional illustrators and sort of, you know, dabble a little bit in a lot of different media. And it was a good skill building process. It was also very demanding, and you know, it was just demanding of my time and energy. And the artist within me was still burning to explore my own work. And I realized after a while that that wasn't happening as a hobbyist on the weekend or late nights. Just wasn't carving out the kind of time that I wanted to pursue my personal work. And so after a few years of that, several years of that, my wife and I decided we were ready for a change and made the transition that landed at CMP, where my goal was to switch gears and really dig in on my fine art and make that my priority. And so these days, I'm calling myself a conceptual pop painter and multimedia artist, which I know is a little bit of a mouthful, so I will walk you through it. My main priority is as a painter, specifically a pop painter, and by that, of course, I mean to follow in the tradition of some of my heroes' influences, like Andy Warhol, Roy Lichtenstein, Keith Haring, where I used to see some of his pieces around New York City back when I was in art school, James Rosenquist, my particular favorite. Milton Glaser, the godfather of modern graphic design, they call him. Learned to appreciate him in art school, but ironically, I had already been influenced by him as a kid, and in that first grade notebook I showed you, I attempted to replicate this in crayon from memory, because my brother had this poster of Bob Dylan on his wall in his bedroom, so that's as good as I can one of the better ones from that notebook. I also love surrealism, so that's always been a big influence on my work as well. Rene Magritte especially. I love his dream imagery, but also love the very sort of poster-like design sensibility that he brings to the canvas. And of course, who doesn't love Dali, another huge influence. And then we move on to realism, and Edward Hopper is a big favorite. As well, the way he captured light and shadow, as well as master of composition, paid close attention to some of the things he brought to his work. And then nowadays, I'm also inspired by a lot of the street artists and muralists, and that whole genre, people like Shepard Fairey, who bring that social consciousness messaging through their work as well. Ron English is another one, very studied, astute painter. But he also has that sort of sense of whimsy that Dina was talking about, and messages coming through. I was lucky enough to be juried into a show by him, he was the juror. That was a huge honor for me, that was in Baton Rouge. And of course, Banksy, the way he can simplify things and just get such a powerful message across public spaces. And so when you take all of those sort of influences together, the pop art aesthetic, surrealism, sense of graphic design, appreciation of realism, and that additional component of social commentary, you get a conceptual pop painting. then, we throw in a few more skills and interests that I have, singer-songwriter. You're going to hear some of what I've done in this presentation. Voiceover artist, which is something I've done commercially. when she did the advertising for it. Art director, as I explained, digital artist, still use those tools preliminarily before I get to paint, and video producer occasionally. There's a lovely little clip on YouTube. And there's her conceptual pop painter and multimedia arts. I'll leave her that in the form. Thank you for indulging me. So that's me. This is sort of an icon in my image that I've created, this AirSats logo, but it was intentionally to convey that sense of handmade quality and humanity that I like to convey through my work. Here's a little overview of some of my work. Together what seems to be some sort of narrative, but you're not really sure. But it gets you to start thinking. What's the connection between these elements? Why are the groceries upside down? You know, what's coming through the window there? Lipsticks look so amazing and candy-like. Why? Why are they there? And then as I started looking into his background, I discovered that he came from a commercial background and was a billboard painter back when they employed those people, and was quite adept and had honed his painting skills, realistic painting skills that way. But now he was switching gears and getting the same sort of stopping power that you do out of advertising, but creating his own narrative and combining things and creating a sense of mystery without the need to sell you anything other than the art itself. And the key to all of this is juxtaposition. Because I find that when you present unexpected images together, it creates tension and elicits curiosity from the viewer. The first time I tried this was my first piece when I transitioned here to Florida. And so it's kind of a personal statement, but I had been thinking about fireworks. Love firework shows, who doesn't? And much like clouds, sometimes you can see other images in them. Sometimes they look like waterfalls or swimming fish. And more often than not, I would see these big bursts and then drooping down, it reminded me of palm trees. Having already been a fan of Florida and the environment down here, my wife and I had been vacationing down here for years from New York before we lived here. And so we associate sunsets on the beach and palm trees as that feeling of relaxation and elation and happiness. And so they both together kind of just elevate that sensation, that feeling of celebration. And for me, it was a celebration, and I call it State of Independence because of that feeling that I was achieving by sort of rebooting my career. And for each new piece, I usually write a few words just to give the viewer a flavor of what the theme is. Beautiful palm standing tall, backlit by sunset's wooded palette. Gaze, relax, unwind. Brilliant fireworks, first loom large in the summer sky. Yeah, this awe, jubilation, freedom. This must be the place. And so I'll take you a little bit into the process of how I get to finding the right imagery to convey what I'm trying to achieve. I'm going to give you a couple of case studies. And for the first one, I was thinking about this just the element of greed and how it seems to be permeating a lot of our society, specifically American greed. It just seems to be a big part of our conversation and part of our motivation these days, for better or worse. And a lot of you are laughing. You remember this great documentary, Morgan Spurlock, several years ago, made the experiment, for those of you who haven't seen it, of dining on nothing but McDonald's hamburgers for a month, and gained about 25 pounds in the process. So there's a standing, you know, symbol of the downside of greed. Gorging on things that we love, you know, too much can be a bad thing. But we live in this big gulp society, right? It's everywhere. We're starting young, wanting more, wanting bigger, bigger, better, faster, louder. I want it all, I want it now. You know, it's not just food, it permeates into just consumerism in general. We're never satisfied, we want more, and it permeates in our, you know, the corporate world to often ill effects. People get laid off because of the bottom line. Too much is not enough. And so, in order to sort of convey this notion that I'm having about greed, in society, I'm looking for symbolism to do my painting. And I found inspiration in this old limerick that has been popular in Florida, especially, and because of our humble name is the pelican. A wonderful bird is the pelican. This bill will hold more than his belly can. He can take it as meat, food enough for a week, but I'm damned if I see how the hell he can. 1910, that was written. And so could it be that our humble pelican might be the perfect foil or symbol for wanting too much, having that big beak that can just fit it all and we'll worry about how we digest it later. What else? What else can I add to the mix? Something I respect. How about the All-American Burger? It's on every menu. They get bigger and fattier and greasier everywhere you go. And they loom from giant billboards on the highway and from our 50-inch TV screens at 2 in the morning and say, aren't you hungry? Don't you want this? You want this now, don't you? Yeah. So it seemed to fit the bill. And how else to convey America quickly, telegraph it to the audience, Old Glory will do the job. And so you're about to see that painting come alive before your eyes with a song inspired by that number that I wrote.
Like a man, and pelican, pelican, your mouth can hold more than your belly can. Now old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O, and on this farm he had some corn, so much it had to go. Yeah, he put it in the burgers, he put it in the fries, he made it fast and cheap, now little Johnny's super-sized. Pelican, pelican, you look to me just like a man. Hey, pelican, pelican, your mouth can hold more than your belly can. Now Jack and Jill went up the hill just to chill and watch some tube. But listen, kiddies, can't you tell? The TV's watching you. Yeah, they track you with your cable, cell phone, GPS, and web. You know they just can't wait to put a chip inside your head. Pelican, pelican. Hey, are you hungry? Yes, I am. Pelican, pelican. Your mouth can hold more than your belly can. They dumped it on the wall, yeah, with barrels full of oil. That Humpty Dumpty's got to fall, yeah, his blood is gonna boil. We'll smart bomb his whole country, we'll bring him to his knees. We've got to get that gasoline to fill our SUVs. Pelican, pelican, you look to be American. I'm pelican, pelican. Yeah, your mouth can hold more than your belly can. Now Mary, Mary, quite contrary, why does your garden glow? With nuclear facilities, yeah, within a pebble's throw. They told us it was simple, so safe and clean and fun. Let's microwave the human race who needs the wind and sun. Pelican, pelican, you look to me just like a man. Hey, pelican, pelican, your mouth can hold more than your belly can.
You know that you want.
Pelican, pelican, yeah, you look good, look good like a man. Hey, pelican, pelican, your mouth can hold more than your belly can. Now, pelican, 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 pelican.
better. We want it all, and we want it now. But like the pelican, we sometimes want more than we can handle. So, how much is too much? So we're dealing in the land of metaphor. Occasionally use the canvas as a bit of a soapbox, you know, sort of share my views, but in a fun, engaging way. I'm not trying to hit you over the head with it, I'm just trying to get you thinking. Food for thought. Okay, in the next one, I want to talk about social media. I was thinking about that. And, you know, who remembers the internet when it was anonymous? Anyone? Yeah, that's over. Thanks to Facebook. And it's not just them, it's TikTok and YouTube, Instagram, X, formerly Twitter. People love them. Obviously, they're hard to resist. I'm on them. And the perception, of course, is that they're free services. How great is that? Because you can connect with friends and family, you can make new friends, you can share photos and videos, post articles and news items, alert your friends about things, and even send private messages. On the dark side, what's the reality? How are these companies staying in business? They're marketing platforms. Every word you type is data linked. Okay, they're saving it, they're scanning it. Advertising is catered to your personal interests, and that's how they do it. They see what you're posting about and talking about, and oh, there's an ad that was just the thing I was talking about. Isn't that weird? They create this valuable, ever-growing database of your life, basically, and they scan your private messages. Even Gmail does that. They plant cookies on your computer to track your activity on other websites when you're actually off of them. And these days, it's very commonplace and expected that law enforcement will use these platforms for intel gathering when there's a crime being investigated. And so, what do? We want in. So we scan past the 5-6 pages of legal mumbo-jumbo and hit accept. Click. And because why? Because everybody else is doing it. That makes us a little cheap. Here's my piece all about that.
With the push of a button, we can all be connected. To hell with the information being collected. So we follow the leader, but we're misdirected. And never seem to notice that we're being inspected. Well, it's all good and it'll be okay. Everything'll be fine if you just do what we say. So click accept and sign. Well, you can trade on your time and you can trade on your will. But what is it worth for you to trade on yourself? And how many people can you really call friends? Poke them and tag them, but you'll know in the end. Well, it's all good and it'll be okay. Everything'll be fine if you just do what we say. So click accept and sign up today. It'll work out fine if you just do what we say. If you just do what we say. Sacrifice me. time when you could make a fair trade. You could tell a man's worth by the stuff that he made. Now it's a digital chess game and we're all gonna play. But those zeros and ones are gonna wreck us someday. But it's all good and it'll be okay. Everything will be fine if you just do what we say. So just say yes and look the other way. It'll work out fine if you just do what we say. If you just do what we say. It's all trust the new way. So pay no mind and sign your life away. It'll work out fine if you just do what we say. If you just do what we say.
Truth is stranger than fiction. Classic suspense meets future shock. They're coming, there's nowhere to hide. And just to touch on my technique, you're seeing a lot of me masking and unmasking and remasking, and that's how I've sort of managed the competing imagery. It's a little more, if you're an artist in the room, you know, it's a little more easy to control doing two different scenarios when you've got nice hard edge to sort of keep one at bay and then reverse the process and work on the other part of the canvas. I've been using masking tape, a little bit of liquid frisket at times. It's served me well and keeps things more manageable. Sometimes when I first started doing it, I had to plot it out the instructions when we first. Figure it out. Now I've got it kind of down. Yeah. So, and then I was thinking about women. But more specifically, women's empowerment was on my mind. And I was wanting to convey something good about that, sort of the celebration of Women's Month and International Women's Day. And I'm not going to belabor the introduction on this. You can see this one coming away. excellent diptych to me. It's a nice way to convey that. Images. I just want to make sure this is working. Okay, here we go. I'll get through this. Drive, passion, elegance, style. The life of the modern-day woman can be a real balancing act. It takes gut instincts and clear-minded goals, well-honed skills, executed with intensity, and tempered by finesse. Giving it all you've got, but never letting them see you sweat. Some ladies just have it all. So it's that duality of the modern woman that I wanted to convey. And so the double image, you know, the ballerina, you know, capturing the feminine side and that finesse, and then the drill showing that power and inner strength and endurance. So we've talked about a lot of different themes, and I continue to explore new ones. This is just a quick montage that goes through some of the ones we talked about, like greed, how it permeates through society. This is one that really talks about artificiality and how it can impact the environment, so environmentalism. I've done a few, like Power and Grace. This one's called Tough Love, another personal empowerment image. This one was mental health awareness. You know about this one? Social media. Pitfalls of the internet. And so that, and the thrones, and a number of pieces, is a recurring theme in terms of how we're constantly embracing new technology as it comes. It's coming fast and furious these days. We also don't have a choice. We have to keep up. It keeps coming at us. I tend to stop and pause and think about them as each new development happens. Is this a good idea? And how is this going to impact us in our day-to-day life? And our privacy and our security and all those good things. Our livelihoods. So that is definitely something I keep coming back to. And so with all of my work, what I like the viewer to do is look deeper. To take a pause and let the wheels turn a little bit, put the pieces together, try to, you know, dissect what the images might mean and how they're interacting and what kind of a narrative that tells what was in my head, but also what might be in your head and then react to it. So it's a back and forth. Doing this kind of work, as Dina so kindly mentioned, has opened some doors, given me some nice opportunities in my art career. I did get a chance to show art in Boston, Miami, both physically and virtually. There's digital exhibits. Digitally, my work with that piece was actually seen at the Louvre. I don't know how that happened. Pretty crazy. same way at Armory Arts Week, and then locally, you know, I've been able to display my work at the MFA and WADA member of Warehouse Arts District in St. Pete, for those of you not aware. I did show at Gasparilla, got an award there. So yeah, I've had some nice opportunities, some good showcases, a few awards along the way, a few grants. So it's been an interesting ride. And for all of that, I am very grateful, as I am for you, your patience, and your interest in being here today. Thank you so much. It means a lot. And with that, I'll do a little less talking and hope to hear from you. If anybody has any questions, we can do a quick Q&A session if you have some time left. If anybody has a burning question.
When you just said one of your pieces about marketing 2.0 was in the loop, was it in the loop digitally?
Yeah, and it was a temporary pop-up show, and it was part of something that I was involved with. So what they did is they had a room in the loop, and the picture is great. I should actually include it through the window. You can see it there, like out the window. It's really there. But they had a couple of digital displays and an opening, basically, that was all featuring artists that were on the roster and juried into that particular venue. Yes.
I saw your piece of creative analysis, you know, all the octagons or whatever.
Oh yeah.
Amazing. I got a quick glimpse of it. Did you make all those canvases or did you find those canvases available some way to fit so many together?
I was thinking about making them and I was relieved to find out they were available.
Great piece.
Thank you so much. Yeah, for those of you who haven't seen it, it's sort of a honeycomb effect where they're all hexagonal panels about yay big, but it kind of appears to be a random pattern. But I use it to show lots of different elements from downtown St. Pete. It was sort of an homage to my appreciation of downtown St. Pete and all my favorite things about it. So it's art, music, culture, food, you know, natural beauty, all the good stuff. Beer is in the background. All my groups and everything going on. And then that overall shape had some significance when I hit on this. I thought this is meaningful and something not everybody's going to notice. It creates the outline of the map of downtown St. Pete proper. So yeah, thank you. That was nice. Another nice showcase at Creative Analysis. I've been involved with them for a few years, and they keep inviting me back. That's some of the hands.
From beginning to end, and I'm talking about in your thought process, you obviously create not a painting, but a sketching of how you want everything, to the final choice of colors. What is your length of time, say, for a piece like that? That's ingenious. I love that piece.
Thank you. You know, some of them come to me quickly, like an idea, like a complete idea, and some of them are more an exploratory process, which was more what I was describing, where I have this theme and then I'm searching for images that make sense with that theme and that feel right together. I think I sketched that pretty quickly. I was watching a show on PBS several years ago, and it was somebody doing a book, lecture on their book, and it was called The Facebook Effect, I think. And it was delving into all the sort of stuff you don't know about social media. And so that kind of came to me in a flash. That's the silhouette they give you before you put your face there. For men, anyway, that's the generic sort of thing.
Yeah.
The prep time on that was probably shorter. By the way, that's Dolly, the clone sheep. Remember the first clone sheep? Again, so just sort of another little nuance that was kind of funny to include. But I will say, it's always a tough question for me because I stop and go a lot. The painting process and all the prep, I mean, the sort of digital, I work digitally and create a montage, with reference material and just to get a sense of, how everything's interacting, get my colors established, and then use that as a roadmap to paint from. And it's a good question because that part of it, I usually don't factor in. The painting part, I usually say about a month over, several weeks because a lot of this is downtime with the masking and waiting for parts to dry and then remasking and all that good stuff. And then the prep, that does add, probably, it may not be a week of working on it, but it might be mulling over. So there is some substantial time ahead of that process too.
Yeah. I thought I gave it 6 months. I don't know.
What?
I in my head I was thinking about 5 to 6 months.
Oh dear no. I'm slow but I'm not that slow.
Okay.
I know a guy who does it in like 2 days.
Okay.
I try to
move
along.
I guess I'm going at my speed.
And it depends on the piece. I mean, like some of them are large diptychs and they're much more complex. I mean, I've worked on those for months. That's very true. Yeah. So okay. It can be that long process. Okay.
Well, in addition to really excellent originality and creativity, because it is thought-provoking and it does deliver, your art delivers important messages, obviously. A couple of other things that struck me were that, you're telling a story. Also, as you make the art, you document that. So your background in, I guess, videography and multimedia and advertising comes through it, but you're telling that story of creating the art. So I'm curious about that too, because I think the videos and the case studies were excellent. You used time-lapse photography.
Mm-hmm.
You set a camera up and mm-hmm. you let it run maybe for days or for certain moments. So I find that quite intriguing. What is that process like?
Yeah, that can be tend to add time. I tend to add some time, and I've shied away from it more recently. Some of these are yeah, it can, depending on how pressed for time I am, I'd love to do it. And so what I was doing was using a digital SLR camera and hooking it up to my computer with software that will trigger it to shoot a frame, you know, every how many seconds. And so that generally controls the speed of it and how much information I'm getting. Granted, if it was every single moment of the process, it would be excruciatingly long. So there's definitely moments I know that I'm going to be pretty productive that is worth capturing, and then even after the fact, if it's going too slow, I'll speed it up. You have that kind of control over it. And then editing, chopping the fluff out, and just trying to make it watchable. so that is a whole other process. And of course, they need a soundtrack, so I'm right, I'll sit down and write a song. Which is funny. Sure. Yes?
When you were talking about how early on in your childhood you started drawing, I was wondering if your parents were supportive of that, you know, through your childhood up until it was time to go to college, were they supportive of you making art?
Yes, and I should have made a point of that. Thank you for pointing that out. I was very lucky to have very supportive parents. You know, they saw something in me, they could see the interest, and they could see the skill was coming to me early for whatever reason, and I was lucky that they didn't, you know, make me shy away for any reason. I never was really embraced school all that much, and it felt like it was going to be in some way, shape, or form my career path. So I stuck with it, I got good feedback, I said, all right, we're on to something here. Oh, as a matter of fact, that Bob Dylan picture, that notebook, I was caught in first grade drawing my mom. And the teacher came over and said, what are you doing? And she started looking through and said, I'm going to take you down to the principal's office. And I said, oh, get in trouble. So they marched this little kid, first grade, well, not that little, I was this tall. And it's Sister Marie Regina, for any of you who grew up in Catholic school. She had a pretty tough reputation. And I'm brought into her. I've never been there before. I wasn't expecting to or wanting to go in there. Sits me down, and she's smiling like I've never seen her. She's flipping through. She's giving me, lighting up. And I said, oh, this is wonderful. Well, you deserve a prize. And why don't you take some candy from that bowl there? I said, what? Maybe I'm on the sun. So yeah, it's that kind of encouragement that got me at least not afraid to keep going. Yes?
You say you grew up in a suburb of New York. What town did you grow up in?
The Eastchester Scarsdale area in Westchester County.
Yeah.
You know the area?
Yeah, I went to school there and taught there for 33 years.
Oh my God.
I worked for an art museum.
Oh, really?
So I came out and
said, oh, that's so great. Wow. Okay, that's great to hear. Yeah. Yes?
A comment. I think you're very, very well spoken and explained your process very, very well. And your business experience probably led you to be able to do that. So thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, that's one of the nice things I brought with me from my dad's career. I had to do this. I had to stand in front of crowds to, like, I got involved in a lot of new business pitches. So, and I'm by shy, you wouldn't, maybe you don't believe me, but I'm shy by nature. So, and I think a lot of artists are. I'm a little reluctant to get in front of people. And I had to really suck it up and really push myself to do those presentations back then. And but yeah, it's one of those sort of part of my skill set that I'm happy I experienced. It kind of helps these days as well.
I'm sure you probably saw us if you're tapping our toes to the music yet. Is your music available? Because I really like it.
Oh, yeah. Cool. Thank you. That's really nice of you to ask. Most of them I've just been putting out. Yeah, I mean, I'm putting them on things like Bandcamp. I was just putting them up on my website and putting them on the videos, but then I started to release a couple commercially a couple years ago. So there's like three songs that you literally can find on Spotify if you use that, or whatever else, Apple what's my music name and helps differentiate me from another Mark Mitchell out there on iTunes. I'm like, no, that's not mine. This is mine. So I did that. Mark James Mitchell, that's where you can search for that stuff. And I'll definitely be putting up more to come. But there's just three of them out now. Yes?
Mark, if I understood correctly what I saw, you masked some paper down and then drizzled some paints on that paper and it allowed only so much pigment to seep through. What kind of paper was that?
I think what you're talking about, I would mask off a whole section of canvas. You're saying like basically to protect it?
Well, no, if I understood correctly, I think that was not just the sun protection, but you also drizzled some paint on top of some paper, a couple of points, I thought, that allowed only so much pigment to seep through.
No, it wasn't like trying to get it to like a mesh or anything like that. It was literally, you're just seeing extra overspray. Some of the pieces have a splattered paint technique in it, and so if there's paper there, I'm protecting the surface.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not coming through. It's hitting the areas around it. Mm-hmm.
Was it talking about you had made some stencils?
Yes.
For the ballerina one.
Yes.
So maybe that's what he meant?
Oh yeah, I did do some stencil work. Occasionally break out some spray paint, depending on the needs. Sometimes it's just more expedient and an effective way to treat some of the shapes, the graphic shapes that don't have a lot of rendering involved. So is that too? I think I saw another hand. Yes.
Well, I'm wondering, is there somewhere that perhaps people could come see your work?
Indeed, they can. Thank you for asking. Why, on the internet, you can follow me on Facebook and YouTube at Mark Mitchell Studio. That's what you look up there. Or if you're on Instagram, it's MM Studio Art. And my main website has links to all the social media as well as all my art and my backstory and all that good stuff. And there's an option to get on an email newsletter if that's what you prefer. There's, you can sign up there. And if you want to see more work like this in person, I happen to have a solo show granted to me in downtown St. Pete at a wonderful little gallery called Woodfield Fine Art. They have a great range of local artists here. And half the gallery is sort of salon style, lots of different local artists' work. And then on the right side is a solo space that's reserved for monthly or bi-monthly solo shows. So I am the current one. I've already opened it, but it's open through the 13th of April. That night will be a closing party, and it's during Second Saturday of Art Walk St. Pete. If you're familiar with that, it's when all the galleries and art spaces stay open late, so it's a real fun night to be there. I'll be there. But if you can't make that night, it is open daily, Wednesday through Sunday, during regular business hours. So it's a big difference when you see the work in person, and I appreciate if any of you want to make the journey down. I appreciate it.
The palm trees. That one with the fireworks and the palm trees is amazing.
Yes, that's showing. That's in the show.
And small ones where it's the design. I had no idea.
That's the one we're talking about.
Yes.
That's called the Berg Hive. And those hexagons were intended to echo the shape of the hexagonal sidewalk blocks throughout the city. I think we're probably at it. Yes.
I think we are. And there are some wonderful business cards over here. You should grab a screenshot of the contact information.